गुड आफ्टरनून मैम। हेलो, यू आर ऑन म्यूट मैम। म्यूट, यू आर, कैन यू हियर मी? यू आर ऑन म्यूट।
Can you hear me now?
या आई कैन हियर यू।
Yeah.
ओके,
Okay.
हेलो मैम, आई एम श्वेता।
Hi, Sweta.
हाय। सो या एवरीथिंग ऑन ट्रैक? कैन यू हियर मी and listen to
Yeah.
me clearly?
I can hear you. Should I try and share my screen so that we
Yeah,
can have
please do
everything
that.
perfect?
Yeah.
Disabled. My screen share is
I've
disabled.
enabled it right now. I've enabled it. There are no videos, ma'am, right?
No, there are no videos.
Okay, great.
Are we able to see the screen?
Yeah, clearly.
And it's changing now. Yeah.
Yeah, on track.
All right. Great. Okay. So, should I just leave this on and we'll start on in some time?
Yeah. You can leave it on. You can mute yourself. We'll
Okay.
start in a while. Yeah, we should start at about 1:14, 1:15.
Okay, yeah, we
Okay.
are ready.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, are we good to go?
Yes, I'm ready.
Okay, so we'll begin in a minute.
Yeah.
Hi, ma'am. I'm Harish.
Hi. Hi, Harish.
We'll start in probably half a second or so. We're there almost.
Okay. Okay.
Good afternoon, all. I just wanted to remind you that there was one session that was missed out in the morning. So the session with Anita Savica, fashion jewelry designer from Latvia, is rescheduled for 3:30 to 4:15. Please be informed and be there. So following an interesting morning session with talks by Dr. PVM Rao from IIT Delhi and architect Adrian Light from Australia, we now begin the afternoon session. Our first speaker for the afternoon is architect Aishwarya Tipnis. She is an architect, educator, and a conservation professional based in New Delhi, India. An alumnus of School of Architecture, School of Planning and Architecture, New Delhi, she has nearly 2 decades of experience in the field of architectural and urban conservation, and has pioneered several urban conservation and building restoration projects in India. Aishwarya is a recipient of the highest civilian honor in the culture sector, the insignia of Knight of the Arts and Letters by the Government of France in 2018 for her outstanding commitment to the preservation of French heritage in West Bengal. She is also the recipient of the UNESCO Award for Heritage Conservation in the Asia-Pacific region in 2016. Today, she shall be presenting her work, Play the City, the Chandranagore project. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you for so many words. I hope I can make justice to it. So I'm just going to quickly share my screen and then we can start. Is it visible to everyone? Yeah.
Yes, yeah.
Okay, so good afternoon. Firstly, thank you so much for such kind words and the opportunity to mainstream our ideas of heritage and design. When I read the theme of the conference was about toying with design, it seemed almost natural that we would share about our experiments with Chandranagar. For all of you who don't know much about Chandranagar, it is a small town located about 40 kilometers north of Calcutta and now falls within the Kolkata metropolitan region. As you can see on my slide, the little red dot is where Chandranagar is in India. So now, what's so special about Chandranagar? It was one of the 5 French-owned territories in India. And at the time of India's independence, there was a referendum, much like Brexit, where the people of Chandranagar voted to be part of India, while the other 4 territories voted to remain with France. Thus, Chandranagar joined the Union of India and became a part of the state of West Bengal in 1951, while the other territories joined India much later in 1954 and became part of the Union Territory of Pondicherry. Now, why this political event is so important is because what happened after is really shaped the history of and the fate of Chandanagar, so to say. So because I joined the state of West Bengal, somehow it got overshadowed by Calcutta, which was a much more important in a metropolitan city. And Chandanagar was relegated into a suburban town, as opposed to Pondicherry, which was then developed as a, you know, French touristic destination. And it, they went on to very different paths. So Chandanagar is also part of a bigger story. The story that begins in the 17th century on the western banks of the river Hooghly, where there were trading settlements of five European countries in close proximity to each other. The Danish at Serampore, the Dutch at Chinsura, the British at Kolkata, the Portuguese at Bandel, and the French at Chandanagar. Chandanagar, unlike Pondicherry, was where in Pondicherry there were distinct black and white districts. But Chandanagar, the architecture is actually a potpourri of French and Indian aesthetics, producing a unique Indo-French aesthetic. Now, all of this was neither recognized nor protected as heritage, and it seemed too ordinary and too small. Yet, the ensemble was ensemble value was immense. Now, our involvement in Chandanagar began in the year 2010, when we began with the listing of buildings of heritage value. And that is a story for another time. However, the main point I would like to highlight here is that we realized through the process of listing that heritage wasn't just about buildings. It was about the people who lived then and the people who live now. So through our initiative, the Heritage and People of Chandanagar, in 2015, we began working with the local community and particularly students to help them discover, understand, and appreciate their town's heritage. The website that was created as part of this project put up all of our work, and it became a starting point for others to learn from and to build upon. So I'm going to begin with what we are going to talk about today. And through our 10 years in Chandanagar, we have experimented with various ways of engaging with heritage. And I will take today's time to share some of them. The first one, which I call play with the city. So the first stereotype really that we were trying to break was that heritage is pristine and that it can't be tampered with. So when we started with the idea that heritage could also be fun, of course, as a grassroots level initiative, we didn't have much funding, nor did we have the resources to, buy expensive Lego, which has the pieces that you could make a nice heritage building with. So in 2015, we conducted a workshop with local students where we sort of decided that we could improvise and the students could imagine how they looked at a heritage building and use regular Lego blocks to showcase what they were seeing. Because as a heritage architect, the way we look at buildings and the way regular people look at buildings are two very different things. And I call this whole thing a Chandanagar experiment because we didn't know what we were getting into. We didn't have predictive results that this is what would come through. There were things that we had thought would work, which actually didn't. And then there were other things such as this Lego experiment, which worked wonders because when we started the workshop, there were these really shy kids who were not even talking to each other, who came in thinking what they were going to do. And then on the table, we laid out all these pieces of Lego and we told them that they could make any heritage building that they liked. And through this entire process, we saw their barriers breaking. We saw that they started collaborating and they started creating something from their imagination, which I think is really the takeaway from any sort of workshop. So we further refined this idea and we had the support of the Union Francaise and the consulate in Kolkata, as well as the French Institute. We had an Indo-French Lego workshop in 2018, where French and Indian students tried to build two scale models of the heritage structures along the promenade. you know, the feedback from the workshop is what I'm always interested in, because that really gives us insights into what's really worked and what's really failed. So in this particular workshop, the feedback that came was that the students, they were very happy that they got to learn how buildings are built, and they got to learn what for example the importance of columns and beams, and that structures would fall if the columns were not in the right place. And most importantly, again, they learned to work in new groups, with not with their friends, but just randomly people they met at a particular workshop. And I think that was important. And these were students who were like 15 to 16 years old, and how they collaborated and communicated to create these scale Lego models of the city was one thing that was very interesting for us. The another thing we did, playing with the whole idea of heritage, was most of the heritage that we did as part of this project was academic, and we wanted students to explore it and have fun with it. So as part of Bojur India in 2017 and 18, we launched a competition along with the French Institute in India to between schools on students of age group 13 to 17 years to produce a board game building on our research of French heritage in India. So the students were free to choose a subject. They were free to design the game, draw their own guidelines, and we received some really incredible games exploring the theme of French heritage in ways I hadn't even imagined. For example, this was a game that was created by some students, and they called it Jeu de Symmetrie, or the game of the symmetry, where the game was designed in a way that you could explore the symmetry and learn about the people who are buried there by playing this particular game. The students really produced like high quality work, and it was really difficult to choose a winner. The feedback again that we received from the participating students was that they had never thought that history or heritage could be so much fun, or it was be something that could be played with. And that learning in an interactive way through game was quite an interesting thing for them. So that was like one aspect where heritage actually became the subject of play. And I think that's that really broke a lot of stereotypes in the way people think of heritage. The second aspect was playing for the city, you know, where heritage became a way to bring people together and help them discover the city and build a sense of pride. So on Independence Day weekend in August 2015, we set up a stall on the public space known as the Strand, and we laid out tables and invited people to come and play with us. So different games were designed for different age groups, and each with the aim of discovering the town. So people participated enthusiastically, and we triggered a lot of curiosity about the place. And people not only played, but also gave us much more information about the things that we didn't know. For example, some historic shops or something that had happened a long time ago. And it became sort of like a collaborative and a co-creation process just through simple play. We also collaborated with school children and Indian and French students to develop simple artworks and in key installations in public heritage spaces like the main jetty or the gateway. And these installations helped in articulating the needs and the aspirations of the community. So these the process of creating these artworks was a game in itself. So our teams had to become citizen journalists and had to find their own clues and then articulate that through public space artwork. Now, students role play as correspondents and journalists. We had them create like a 4-page handmade newspaper to showcase their findings. Now, they wrote articles, they designed advertisements, and we had a hard time choosing out of the 94 entries that we received of these 4-page newspapers. Now, somebody did ask me this question that, you know, you could have asked them to make a video, you could have asked them to make a film, why did you ask them to make a 4-page handmade newspaper? And I think the idea was that we really wanted the process to be very inclusive, and so that even students from the municipal schools could participate. And more than that, I feel when you do something with hand, the learning is much more than just, you know, trying to use a software and make something. I mean, that's personally my point of view, but I may be a little analog myself. So the lastly I would like to talk about is the third aspect of the project, which is playing in the city. So as designers and architects, we're often, you know, either criticizing or we have these really big dreams for our public spaces. So through our initiative, which is called Juvarapolis, and we are going to have a workshop after this, we aimed at co-creating designs for play in the public space. So in this case, we had a 7-day workshop between Indian and French multidisciplinary design students, as well as students from the local community. And we used a design thinking methodology and a model where students co-created spaces for children to play on the promenade. Now, there were a couple of things that we wanted to, you know, sort of emphasize. We wanted to emphasize on the temporarity. At the same time, we wanted to use sustainable materials, and we wanted to recycle as much as was possible. We had a French expert, Samuel Remy, who's a villet maker and who you can see in the picture with the bench, who is an expert at upscaling things in public spaces. And it was a great collaboration where we were able to, you know, not just design, but also work with our hands. So the students actually interviewed local communities to create these low-tech solutions from waste material that was available to them. Now, the workshop was not just about designing, but it was also about making. It was also about hands-on work to prototype and to build on site. And most importantly, to receive the feedback from the community that they had designed it for. And I think the most interesting thing then was to see how people were coming together, how people were giving suggestions and feedback, saying, don't do it like this, do it like this, or to say, maybe you could do this, maybe you could do that, I really like this, I don't like this. So I think the live feedback was something that was pretty exciting, and that was something that we could have, we really learned from. So in a nutshell, I would like to say that since I would really like to talk about this more as question answer, so I sort of prepared a little short presentation. But the point really is that heritage isn't something that is boring and that stays in history books. Secondly, I think that heritage is a fantastic tool to engage the youth and to generate curiosity. And I think curiosity is one of the key elements that anyone needs to have to be to become a better person, to be a good citizen. The third thing is really that I see heritage as an educational tool to learn about your neighborhood, to know about the spaces that you are in, and it really helps in, you know, bringing people together. And lastly, I think heritage can really be used as a gaming tool to collaborate with the community and articulate their needs. Now, in the workshop that's going to follow this talk, where we have two experts, one in gaming and the another in Lego, which who will help the participants, you know, come up with their own ideas about how to pitch an idea for a game. So I think at this moment, I'd like to say thank you for listening, and let's ask some questions if there are any. Thank you.
Sorry, I didn't realize it was unmuted. Thank you very much, ma'am. Quite an interesting session. There's a few questions before, so I'll quickly read out the questions and then. So Geetanjali asks, what is the most challenging part of the process while conserving heritage?
I think every step of conserving heritage is challenging in its own way, and the challenges vary. Sometimes there are political challenges, sometimes there are social challenges, sometimes there are technical challenges, and the challenges vary from project to project. I think in this example that I was particularly talking about, the challenges were where we had to start from. We had to, people didn't consider what they had as valuable because they liked it, it was their heritage and they connected with it, but they didn't think that it could be leveraged to get a better quality of life, or they didn't think that it was something of value. They didn't understand why people from outside wanted to come and, you know, talk about it so much, because for them it was just regular houses, regular streets, stuff like that. So sometimes we are actually, our challenges are challenges of mindsets, challenges of perception, challenges of what people want. Like sometimes experts want to preserve something, but the community that that heritage belongs to, they don't want to conserve it, they want to move on. So, I mean, to answer Gitanjali's question, there are all kinds of challenges in sizes and shapes and variety that keep coming up in every project. It's different. I can't really put it in a box. You're muted.
I like my voice. There's another question from Karm, something that I wanted to touch upon as well. So he says, craftsmen of India play a huge role in preserving the art and culture of true India, but we are slowly losing them because of the suburban development. You, as a part of conserving these heritages, how do you plan on helping these craftsmen of India to keep them alive? Heritage buildings normally have a lot of involvement from the local community in terms of building them itself. So there's a certain amount of craftsmanship that is developed over a period of time.
Yes.
Because once, after all the developments, rapid development that's happening right now, those people have also diminished. And how do you intend reviving them, or, you know?
So I think the point is not just to revive something, because the point is to make it profitable for them to want to continue it for another lifetime. The reason why people are are changing professions, or are not, you know, they've been craftsmen for 7 generations and in the 8th generation they want to do something else, is because they don't think it is valuable, right? So the thing is, I think the point is not just to, you know, pump money and say, no, you know, you must do this and it's valuable for the country, but it's help them realize that there is going to be an economic benefit from it. So in this case, in the case of Chandan Nagar, when we are, we've been involved with it for 10 years and we are finally at that stage where one particular building is going to get restored through a partnership between the government of France and the government of West Bengal. And the emphasis really is on skill building, is on ensuring that the youth and the craft skills in the community are developed further and that they can be made relevant to today's time, you know, because a certain thing that was done in the 19th century may not be relevant. And so once you finish a project, maybe that guy will not find job again. So I think it's also about what we call upskilling, and to make sure that they pick up the skill and then they can apply it in different ways, you know.
True. So there's another question from Nireka. While restoring the heritage buildings, what will be the materials that you would probably suggest while keeping sustainability in mind? I guess the question is more towards the material that they have actually used in the original times, and how do you actually replace them, or what is the alternate that you actually go ahead with?
So my philosophy is that traditional materials have usually been sustainable materials, which is why they have lasted all these years. Now, this question really depends upon what kind of a building are you trying to restore. If you're trying to restore your house, then I think we have to allow some amount of flexibility given our budget constraints, given the situation we are in. Like, I personally don't take a very rigid look at if, you know, someone had put in Burma teak in your house 300 years ago, and if you can't afford it, that you shouldn't restore it. I think the point is to, and that's what we try to do through our initiative, Jugaropolis, where we are creating an online toolbox called the Restoration Toolbox. If you go onto our website, you'll find it, where we're trying to help you with simple technical solutions so that you can, you know, help yourself in restoring and maintaining your building. So at the moment, our toolbox has plaster, has timber, has tiles, and cast iron as the core elements. And these are students from SEPT who we collaborated with in doing the technical research, and we are putting it in a user-friendly way onto the website so that more people who have these historic buildings can learn from them. Having said that, I think advice of a professional is always good, because sometimes it's a professional having a conversation with you can help you put your money in the right place. You know, other than that, that is sustainability for me, where I am coming from, because a lot of times most people don't choose heritage conservation as an option because it's too expensive. But my personal take on it is it can be made pocket friendly if you plan it well, you know. So if anyone is looking to restore a heritage building, I think first thing they should do is really have a conversation with an expert. It will cost you money, but it will help you save money in the long run.
Super. The next question is from Hitika. Most of the heritage structures are not built in a universal manner. So while restoring one, do you consider converting it into a universal design? I think it's more on accessibility.
Yeah, I think it depends on what the building is being used for. So yes, if you're working in buildings which are institutions and that the law mandates that they are made universally accessible, then yes, of course, the whole idea is to make sure that those design interventions are done in a manner that is most sensitive to the building at hand. I don't think that we can use a standardized design template on all sorts of heritage buildings, because each building is really unique.
There's another question from Heyman. Could you share some outcomes of the project, especially images of the kind of ideas developed in order to develop public spaces for play? I think it's with the workshop that was.
So we had in the images I had shown the public spaces for play that were developed in Chandanagar, which was, it was just a 7-day workshop. And those spaces were, this workshop happened just pre-COVID. So there were a lot of people who were coming into these public spaces, and it was just simple swings and hammocks and stuff like that. Because again, we were trying to prove a point with low-tech solutions and stuff that was already available to us. Unfortunately, after the COVID pandemic, I don't know what the usability of the space was, because of course, everybody went into a lockdown and what happened to it later on. But more information about this workshop can be found on our website. And if there are any specific questions, please feel free to email us. We'll try and answer them as much as we can.
Wonderful. Another question. There's lots of questions. Arpit asks, we are a part of the globalization and the developing country. What strategies do you have in order to keep up with the fast pace in order to conserve heritage?
So I honestly see heritage as part of development. I don't think it is heritage or development. I think it is heritage in development. So of course, it might be a shift in mindset. But the thing is that heritage needs to be made relevant to the contemporary situation. I don't think that there are buildings which are important buildings and monuments which are preserved as such. But there is a lot of other heritage, what we call urban heritage, you know, like houses that we live in, or schools that we go to, or hospitals or hotels, which are all old buildings, right? So they need to be upgraded, they need to be reused, they need to be, they need to bring in new standards of services, etc., to make them, take them into the next century. So I think the point is, if we're looking at sustainable development, heritage definitely has a seat on the table, and heritage is really important for us when you think about our cities and you think about the image of our cities. So I don't think it is heritage or development, it is heritage and development, you know, as a driver for development, honestly.
And I think it goes hand in hand. They have their place and space as well, and it really needs to be taken care of. and taken forward as well. Wonderful, wonderful. Thank you so much for a superb session, and very proud that of your achievements as well as an Indian. Thank you very much for being part of EDW and from UID. Hopefully, we would be able to get you on campus sometime. That would be an interesting session, a masterclass over here for us. Privilege to have you here with us today.
Thank you very much. And if anyone is interested in the way we are doing this, then please do join our workshop, which is going to begin at 3 o'clock, where we are exploring ideas of game design, and everyone's free to join it. Yeah.
Wonderful. Okay. I believe was a limited number workshop. So we've already got participants registered. Only the registered participants will be part of the workshop presently. But thank you very much. We look forward to the workshop as well. I should be there, people, and see what's happening over there as well. Thank you so much. Pleasure.
All right. Bye-bye.
So, for the audience, we'll get back in another 15 minutes for the next session to start at 2 o'clock. At 2 o'clock, we have Professor Sangeeta Shroff, and in a panel discussion with Vinita Nahar, Vijay Pathy, and Judy Freider. 15 minutes, we shall be back. Till then, please enjoy the visuals.